Hello, social workers, mental health professionals, and change agents. Welcome to another episode of the Social Work Friends Podcast. I'm your host, Bash Moreno. Saludos a todos. Greetings, everybody. Thank you for tuning in, tapping in wherever you are watching or listening to this podcast. I appreciate all the love and support. Gracias a todos por su apoyo. Continue to follow the podcast on all the social media outlets, on Instagram at the Social Work Rant Podcast. That is all one word. On Twitter, X at Social Work Rants. And hit the like button on Facebook, aka Meta, at the Social Work Rants Podcast. And of course, YouTube, hit that red subscribe button. And for all my audio listeners, hit the subscribe button, share, like, however you listen to podcasts, is however you listen, you just type it in and listen away. So all eight seasons, some of your favorite social workers have been on, and dope entrepreneurs teaching us how to get the bag and use our social work skills in a variety of different ways. So yeah, so shout out to everybody that's been rocking and supporting and listening and viewing. So it's Pride Month. Happy Pride Month to those who celebrate. Father's Day, as of this recording, is coming up this weekend. So shout out to all the social work daddies out there that keep up the great work. So my guests at this time, but before I talk about my guests, I always forget to do this darn disclaimer. The podcast is not to be used for therapy or individual counseling. If you need assistance with your mental health, call 988. If you have a therapist, call your therapist. If you have a psychiatrist, call a psychiatrist. If you have an emergency, call 911. For all the listeners out of the U.S., out the country, viewers, whatever your emergency phone number is, call that number. If you need assistance, it's okay not to be okay, but get the help that you solely need. So and of course the episode is brought to you by Bass City Entertainment, doing business as Bass Moreno Consulting, providing financial education for people of color in the sandwich generation. For more info, go to www.bassmoreno.com. Join the email list. I'm looking for clients, so I'm working on pricing and all that other good stuff that they don't teach us in social work grad school. So speaking of financial education, financial social work, that is today's main topic for today. And someone who literally just got their certification in financial social work, Joey Laswell. How you doing, sir?
Man, doing well, Bells. How's it going? I'm just happy to be here, man. I have to say, I'm a kind of a fanboy right now because I was literally listening to your podcast while I'm on my way driving to school and to grad school for social work. So this is a really surreal moment for me. Yeah, just fanboying for a second there. So shout out.
Thank you for the support. It's still surreal when people actually come up to me and actually say that. So I really appreciate it.
Yeah, it's just a real surreal kind of thing with social media age. Like, you know, I actually reached out to Catherine Moore from Social Workers Rise, and I was thinking about a podcast idea. I reached out to her, and I used her as a consultant, and we kind of birthed the idea of some of the stuff that I'm working on now. So and then it's just cool to be, you know, part of this, and so I'm just grateful to be here.
Yeah, shout out to Catherine. She's amazing, and yes, I've had her on the podcast, and I did some stuff on hers. So we did the Social Work Wealth Conference last year talking about podcasting, and the conference is coming back, so be ready for that. So I definitely want to see all. Knock on wood, I'll be in New York. Is in New York. It's gonna be in person. So back home, I go in God's will, and see fellow social workers, talk about ways we maximize and make some money.
There you go. I like it.
So, Joseph, let people know who you are and talk a little bit what you're currently doing in the field of social work and what led you to social work, because not the traditional way you got into social work.
Yeah, I've been thinking about like comic books lately and like origin stories, you know, and I was thinking about my social work origin story, and it's a very convoluted path. But, you know, the long story short version, I was in the Air Force for 14 years. I actually did 3 years of college before the Air Force, and I was kind of not sure what to do with myself at that point in time. And the Air Force was like a really a jumping off point for me. It gave me some direction. It helped me, you know, gave me a steady job. It gave me health benefits, which was a big one. I was waiting tables before I joined the Air Force. And had I not been in the Air Force, that following year I got appendicitis and I had to have a surgery. And if I had that happened to me before I joined the service, I would have had a huge surgery bill. So shout out to the Air Force, the military. You know, it's a really good gig. I'm not here to push anyone into the military. I will say that, but it can be really beneficial for a lot of people. But yeah, so I did, I got into, I was finishing up my actual bachelor's in psychology while I was in service. And then, I decided to get out after 14 years. That's a whole nother story. I guess I don't know. It's just, it's a complicated decision to get out after being in that long, but I was ready to do more. And I was really drawn to the helping profession. I had finished my bachelor's in psychology and I was like, I want to go out and start helping people. And you know, I enjoyed my time in the military, but I was also, you know, had a son on the way, and I wanted to start putting down some roots and be there for my son. And so there's a lot of factors, but basically, yeah, I got out I was trying to figure out what to do. You know, I'd had my bachelor's, had a little stint as I was going to be a financial counselor before I transitioned out. I got an internship working as a financial counselor. So I kind of started the financial counseling journey. But yeah, basically I got into social work kind of indirectly through, I started working at the state hospital. It's a, you know, psychiatric inpatient facility. And I was just a technician there. And, you know, it was a good enough job. It was a state job, had good benefits. But, you know, I just felt like I was a little unsatisfied. You know, I wanted to do more again. And
what state
was
this?
What's that?
I'm sorry. What state
this
was
is
this?
In Mississippi. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So I ended up relocating to Mississippi to be closer to family when I got out. Yeah, so I started working as a tech. And then at nights, there was a social worker that would come in and do group sessions, just like a couple nights a week. And I started talking to her, and you know, she's a really cool lady. Basically I was telling her, I was like, yeah, I'm thinking about going back and maybe getting my master's in counseling, because I was like, at that point in time, I was in a psychology mindset where I'm like, yeah, I'm going to get back into, or I'm going to start maybe doing a counseling thing. And then I'll never forget, because she kind of stopped dead in her tracks and just like made eye contact with me. Like, no, you're going to be a social worker. And I was just like, I honestly, before that, I hadn't really known much about social work at all. Mm-hmm. Honestly, I was just like, okay. I was like, okay, you're very adamant about that, but tell me more. So, you know, she was like, yeah, social work is really cool. It's really broad. You can do a lot of different things. And she was like, I think you would be really good at it. And I was, you know, I was kind of like, okay, it's a bit aggressive, but you know, I'm going to look into it. you know, as the more I looked into it, the more I was like, yeah, this really is a cool field. There's like so much things I could do with it. You know, I'm drawn to the helping profession, but Even at that time, I wasn't sure what I wanted to do in the helping profession, but I liked how broad social work is to where I could be a therapist if I want to be, or I could, do something completely different, be an advocacy or, it was like the more I learned about it, I was like, yeah, social work is the right path for me. So I applied to grad school at Ole Miss. Hotty toddy, gotta give credit where credit is due. And then I did the traditional 2-year program, and then basically, yeah, I graduated. I took my licensing exam, my licensure, before I actually graduated, which they allowed me to do, and I passed it my first go around. And I was just fired up. I was like, let's do this social work stuff, I'm getting there. And I got my internship was at the VA in Memphis. I was really excited about that because I was, like gung ho about helping the veterans. Did my internship and then had a great experience. But when it came time to get a job, there was only so many jobs and so many openings at the time, so I didn't get hired on at the VA. But while I was working at the VA at my internship, I actually got partnered with the mental health field or the mental health clinic, and I started kind of doing some extra internship stuff. And then I basically she used to work at the hospital that I work now, and she was like, I think you'd be a good fit here. And when it looked like I wasn't going to get a job at the VA, I was like, well, I need a job. I need to pay the bills,
No, exactly.
Yeah, so I basically jumped at the chance. I got hired on, and I've been a medical social worker since September, doing like case management, things like that, which I never thought I would necessarily be doing, but I'm enjoying it. The experience has been really great, and I still get to work with veterans, which is really cool. It actually worked out. I still get to help veterans, but man, like working in the hospital system, I definitely started to see that there's, especially with these homeless veterans or homeless people in general, I was like, man, like people are struggling with their finances, and I'd already had like an interesting path for my own personal finances. But I was just like, man, I wish there was more I could do to help these people with their finances, and just, like there's got to be more. There's financial literacy, there's, advocacy. There's so many things that I'm like really passionate about, like, and seeing the problems that there was a lot that needs to be done. And then I stumbled upon financial social work, and yeah, it was like light bulbs for me, man. I was just like, nothing against medical social work. I'm still happily employed as a medical social worker. But man, when I found out about financial social work, it was like the skies lit up, and it was just it was like perfect for me. So yeah, that's how my long and convoluted way of saying how I got into social work, and then like basically how I got into financial social work.
Yes, first and foremost, thank you for your 14 years of service.
Thank you for saying that. I appreciate that.
Especially, living here in Delaware, drive by the big Air Force Base in Dover all the
Yeah.
time. So I see those big military planes get ready to go to missions and stuff like that. So or the military helicopters is pretty to see, but they're no joke. So that's first and
Yeah.
foremost. Myself doing medical currently doing medical social work. So I feel you on that. And get financial social work. I found out about it almost two years ago, and then kind of not talking about the Social Work Wealth Conference and Rita, who created the whole certification for it. Shout out to her. Was part of the conference last year and talking about it and got her flowers at the conference, or rightfully so. To a point that, all right, this year I started, I paid it, like hit send. Got sale. So
Yeah, they got me on the sale too.
then I've been going through the books, printed out all five
Ooh,
book at
yeah.
work,
A lot of printer paper right there. A lot of
printer paper. Screw it. Now that I work, it wasn't going to be at home.
Right.
And took a binder, put everything in a binder, and started going through the pages. I downloaded it on my work computer, and like literally whatever breaks I got, and kind of like going through page by pages. I'm more of a notebook type, so
right.
You know, doing stuff on digital is, yeah, I'm going through them, but it's like not sinking into my brain. But and there's, you know, obviously there's a examination, and you know, you pass it and you get your certification. So those are my next steps to be where you
got
are.
It, man. You got
in
it.
Terms of that, like I started taking the test. I'm like, it's open book. It's an open book exam. So like, yeah. Just kind of, well, all right. See, where's the question that I'm trying to find the answer. So some of the stuff I already know, especially like these last 4 years, kind of digging into, you know, finances and started investing
yeah.
and things like that. The boom of financial literacy. Thanks to COVID.
Yeah. We didn't have anything else to do. We might as well learn about how to manage our money, I guess,
exactly.
For better or worse.
Exactly. Especially when we got those steamy checks.
Oh,
so.
Man. Yeah, that was an interesting time to be in the financial world, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But
so,
yeah.
So what are you trying to do with your financial social work certification?
Well, originally I was thinking that I wanted to open like a financial coaching side business, you know, like part of my motivations for this whole thing is was started as a side hustle. I'm like, I need to make some extra money, because as you've mentioned in some of your older episodes, like we don't get paid that great sometimes, you know, like just in as this, you know, just real talk, we don't get the best salary for what we do and what we've been trained to do and what we have to put up with. So, yeah, part of it was it was mostly motivated by, I need extra money, you know, cause like I got bills to pay for my schooling and all this other stuff. And, so I'm just like, I got to bring in extra money. So I started, I basically started building a financial coaching, side business, but I'm kind of throwing everything at the wall right now. So I got a lot of different irons in the fire, but ultimately I kind of have like a social media brand presence, putting out content like personal financial content, you know, just free stuff and just, you know, trying to engage with kind of a community, building a platform of people who are interested in like FIRE. So I created the FIRE Social Worker. And you had somebody recently, as I think a couple of weeks ago or a month ago, that was talking about FIRE, financial independence, retire early. And I listened to that recently and I was like, okay, yeah. So people are talking about it, you know? But then the FIRE social worker just was like, kind of a lightning bolt, just thing that just came into my mind. I was like, well, I'm interested in FIRE. I'm a social worker. All right. FIRE social worker. There we go. So that's literally how it came to be. But I am genuinely passionate about the financial independence community. So there's a little bit of overlap there where I've been following this movement for, man, 10, 12 years now. I've been on my own financial independence journey. It's been a bumpy ride. I can go into that a little bit if you want, but ultimately I made some really bad decisions. I made some great decisions, and then I started making bad decisions again. And now I'm kind of having to pay for the most recent spout of bad decisions. So part of this whole FIRE social work thing is also kind of me sharing my story and my journey with people so that they can maybe not feel so bad about some of the decisions that they've made and the mistakes that they might have made. So I'm trying to kind of humanize, you know, personal finance and give people like a some guidance, some literacy, but also, you know, just engaging with the community and trying to change the narrative around personal finance. Because, you know, as a culture and society, we're just still not good at talking about money, you know? So I'm really,
true.
Yeah, you know, it's just tough, you know? And even in my attempts at financial counseling with people, like one-to-one with no one else around, people get, you know, just like in therapy, sometimes, you know, people don't open up, they're just kind of closed off and you just kind of have to deal with that. But then people will tell you their political beliefs, like at the drop of a hat. But if you ask them about their finances, they turn into, a completely silent person, So yeah, part of my vision is like, I want to change the narrative around personal finance and just, try to create positive content, positive engagement, and I actually just recently, I've been brainstorming, but I'm going to do a financial makeover. So, they have all these extreme makeover shows. You got shows for your home, you got shows for your wardrobe, you got shows for personal fitness or personal finance or personal fitness. So I was like, but you don't really see a lot of personal financial makeovers, and I was like, let's try it, So I kind of put feelers out there in my little communities, and I was like, hey, is anyone willing to be coached live on camera in real time? And then people can follow along with the story and the journey, and maybe even learn a thing or two while they're watching the content. But then it's also a personal interest story where they're like, I'm gonna see this person starting from a really tough financial spot, and then see them hopefully grow, and then follow along. So I actually do have somebody that has agreed to do on this crazy journey with me, because. Like,
oh,
this
nice.
Is all, I'm just making it up as I go along, but I'm just like, yeah, let's try it, So yeah, that's in the works. Basically on actually this coming Sunday, I'm going to be, doing like an initial, assessment with him, live on camera. So that's something that is a kind of exciting for, and then I'm just like, I don't know what this is going to be, but this is kind of cool and fun and different. So, and he's actually an active duty member, so that's kind of cool too. So I get to maybe reach some of my military community members that I'm like, because that's the other thing. When I was in the service, I noticed there's a lot of people that just sucked at money. I mean, for lack of a better word, like they're just not good at their handling their finances. You throw in normal personal finance, which is already hard enough as it is, and then you throw in the struggles of the military lifestyle, and man, you just see people just going ham on their finances. So I think there is a definite need in the military community, active duty, to kind of get better with their finances, because as we've learned and you've learned in your studies, your personal finances can really affect your mental health and your overall wellness. So, yeah, that's just, I guess what I got in the fire right now, but yeah, like, I'm just trying to engage with people and help people. Ultimately I'm putting out just random, I did a whole like 40 minute talk on credit scores, For all I know, I think I know like a couple hundred people have viewed it, but I'm pretty sure they haven't watched the whole thing, but that's fine. If I reach one person with that video, then that's a win for me, So yeah, I'm just trying to distill all the information that I've learned over the years. And at the same time, I'm like mid journey, so I'm looking at other people like, Ava Ford, rich social worker, shout out to her. I'm looking at her like that's where I want to be, So I'm mid journey, and I'm just, and excited to be part of this, personal finance community, but then the social work community too. So that's the other thing. I got veterans. I'm a military community I'm passionate about, and then I got my social work community, which is new to me, but I'm also seeing that we don't get paid enough, or we're struggling with our personal finances too. And if we, as a profession, were for one better paid, but for two, if we were better with our finances, I think that, we would be able to provide better care. I mean, let's just be honest. Like if we're in a better financial place, that's one less stressor for us as professionals to have to bring into our work energy. So,
no,
so I'm a big advocate. Yeah. Big advocate for financial wellness as a whole. And I think that's where the financial social work model really ties it all together. So yeah, I can I can preach about all this stuff for hours. So, just any other questions you have, just let me know because I
No,
can go on forever.
yeah, no, of course, not. That's a great, like, real overview of what you're trying to do. And, a couple of things. First, FIRE is a financial
Independent,
independence and
retire
retire
early.
early community. A lot of social media people talk about that, and there's something you can't achieve if you want to achieve. Is it's a lot of hard work, and like, yeah, for ourselves, yeah, people don't like talk about finances, and even like you might be married to a partner, is like we're talk about finances with your partner,
Right.
is like
That's true.
what kind of what's your credit score like? What type of bills you guys like? We go through the bills, is like how much you own that bill. So
Right.
it's like,
Think about how many divorce marriages could be saved with some good financial, like couples counseling, you know?
absolutely. This is one of the two main reasons of divorce. One is money, and the other one is sex and communications. So it's like, so money is definitely a huge factor, and it's about Men's Mental Health Month, and a lot of us men know traditionally have been like the breadwinners, or society be like the men are the providers and the breadwinners, and everything that happened with COVID and things like that, a lot of people like lost their jobs. People are still losing their jobs now, being laid
Exactly.
off, and furloughs happened. So it's like,
Financial trauma, you know, that's a real thing.
exactly. So the effect you talk about affecting mental health, that's a big part of that. So and just everything you're trying to do, and like you're starting a business, so literally sometimes you gotta throw stuff at the wall, like you just said, and see if something sticks. And you actually got a client that's willing to come on and help. I'm trying to get there, so slowly but surely. So
I'll put you on the list if you want to be a future guest, huh? Because
it,
there might be a wait list after this is all said and done. Fingers crossed. I don't know. We'll see.
really give you something. You gotta manifest that stuff. So yeah, you just never know. But yeah, so but it's just real. It's real. Like you're trying to do a business while having a full-time job. That's work in itself, and you're trying to your job is hard as it is, and then you got family to take care of and bills for. So and then it's a lot human, and that stuff we need to talk about all that. So and that's extremely important, and to have these real conversations and have these honest conversations of like, this is what I'm trying to do, and shout out to Eva, Eva Ford, and amazing coach, and I had her on the podcast, and so I'm made no bones about it. Like I hired Eva to my coach while trying to work on my financial coaching business, and why I'm doing the financial social work to kind of like legitimize like the work that trying to do. And I see the potential of potentially that being a year or two down the line be a full-time type of job, because my people still gonna be messing up their finances, and who knows, whoever's gonna be president, the finances are gonna be screwed up regardless anyway.
Well,
So
maybe we need a certified financial social worker in the office. How about that? Manifest that into existence. Oh man, I'm just talking crazy, but yeah, that I mean, yeah, personal finances affect everybody equally. You know, it doesn't matter what side of the aisle you're on, like finances affect you all equally. So I think that's where if we could come together as a country, it would be about let's talk about finances and just, you know, treat each other like, okay, you're a human being dealing with the financial world just like I am, and let's work together instead of, you know, bringing each other apart. So, But yeah, like, oh, and just to highlight a point that I would love to do this full time as my everyday job. But for the time being, I'm perfectly happy being a medical social worker and grinding and doing this on the side. But if someone wanted to offer me enough money to work off to that's the goal. It's like basically if I could bring enough money to do this and not have a 9 to 5, then that's the dream for me. But that's just my manifestation that I'm trying to put out there.
No, yeah, that would be a dream. It would be your own boss and kind of like work your own schedule and kind of, especially you got family, see them, be able to take your child to school if you could, or
Yeah.
they got like if they're into extracurricular activities, be able to take them, pick them up, kind of
Yeah.
be make the have extra time to actually be a parent, because being a
Right.
parent is so much harder than I think ever
And they're not
been.
exactly cheap either, so
No,
another reason
unless
to keep your money
talking about personal
right.
finances and baseball. My goodness gracious, I think I might do I think I might have to do an episode on that, because
Yeah.
my pocket was
Oh,
my
you're
son's
like during
baseball
like
season.
baseball season. Okay. I thought you were talking about like baseball betting for a second. I was like,
Oh
no,
no,
that's a whole nother can of worms right there. But yeah,
that's our
sports
financial
betting.
leaks, which I talk about.
Yeah. No shame on anyone who does sports betting. I get it, it's the psychologically, I get it, it's exciting. But I actually ran into, or I say ran into, but I stumbled upon a connected on LinkedIn. I think her name is Dr. Chandra Parks, and she's a certified financial social worker, Dr. Parks, I should say, Dr. Parks. Yeah, she turned me on to like there's a real issue going on with gambling addiction in the country, like the sports betting, having it in your pocket and being able to bet like that, it's caused extreme rise in a gambling addiction. So
Yeah, I believe it.
yeah, just I mean just keep an eye on that stuff, put that as a fun money kind of thing. But if you're draining your bank account to do these gambling bets, you just gotta that's a trick a slippery slope right there.
Yeah, absolutely, this and there's so much, the leagues are embedded into these gambling sites now, so and more is coming. So
Right, yeah.
unfortunately, that might be a lane we could
Yeah.
get into
Well, you
with our certifications.
have to get Dr. Parks on to talk about that, I guess.
That
He's the expert.
yes, sure. I'll send a DM like I send you the DM on
There you go.
LinkedIn. So,
Yeah. It's all about networking nowadays.
that is so yes, definitely all about the networking. Now I wanted to piggyback, because you mentioned Catherine and getting her, and she's great. A lot of things that she's doing. So you said you had something else that you're working on in the works, and you want to share what that is?
Man, I'm trying to think. I feel like I have so many irons in the fire. I'm just so I mean I am working on an LLC. I'm trying to create like a an official like online like one-on-one counseling and then maybe some group counseling. So I'm trying to set that up like an LLC for that. And man, what else was it? So I mean, yeah, I got the makeover show coming down the line. Oh, so military broadcast radio. I haven't mentioned them yet, and I feel bad for not saying them yet, but I stumbled upon military broadcast radio. There the VA sent out an email back on January 30th, and it was just like, hey, this nonprofit, they help veterans start up a podcast. So I saw the email and I was like, I kind of want to start a podcast. So this was back in January, and I kind of worked with them. They basically help transition veterans into the podcasting game, and so I kind of pitched them the idea of the Money in the Military podcast and basically a show where we talk about finances for the military. And so I've been working with them. just launched that first podcast episode on Monday, I think it was. And then so yeah, I'm gonna be doing weekly episodes on their platform, the Military Broadcast Radio. They're just a really cool platform. They have like 125 veterans that are on the waiting list to try to become podcasters. So I mean,
Wow.
they've got this they just got a cool platform. And I partnered with them and launched my show. And I'm basically going to be having a weekly show with them. Looks like it's going to be Thursdays at 6 p.m. Central Standard Time, and that's going to be live broadcast on MBR's multiple platforms. So they're on, like, you know, so they use what's you should you pro I'm sure you've heard of sound StreamYard. You know,
Yes,
do you use it, or have you? I don't know.
I've heard of
I'm
it,
yeah.
and I follow some wrestling podcasts that use it.
Yeah. They actually have a wrestling show on MBR, so you might want to check them out, 'cause it's just highlighting veterans who are content creators and giving them their whole platform is giving veterans a voice. So there's just a full spectrum of different types of shows. You've got like a holistic healing, you've got sports, you got sports, all kinds of different sports, politics. So I mean, it's a really cool and growing platform. I encourage that'll be a definitely a thing that I'm gonna keep advocating for. It's because the cool thing about the NBR platform too is that they work with other nonprofits around the country. So they're a nonprofit, but they're partnering with other nonprofits through all the different veteran podcast hosts. So it's just a really cool program. I'm honored to be a part of it, and yeah, I mean, if any listeners are here, and you don't have to be a veteran to or a military member to listen to this content. I think another thing that we're trying to do is to basically almost like a group therapy session where all the veteran voices are being broadcast out there, so the civilians can actually listen to our content and listen to some of the things that we go through on the back end of our service. So yeah, so I feel like everyone can benefit from a little bit of veteran voices in their broadcast stream. So yeah, so that's definitely one thing I want to highlight is Military Broadcast Radio, giving veterans a voice. That's my little free pitch for them. But yeah, they're awesome.
That's great.
Awesome program, yeah.
Congrats on that. That's big.
Yeah, thank you. It's just it's once again, it's all pretty surreal because it was literally like I remember the date, January 30th, when the email came out, and then here I am now, 5 months later, and I launched a podcast with them. So that's like it's just crazy, man. And here I am talking to you on a podcast, talking. It's just like what is happening? Oh man.
Sometimes you just gotta make the time to do it, and I know I struggle with that sometimes. Sometimes if I see something, I'm like, I gotta do it like right there, like on the
Yeah.
spot, or otherwise I'll forget. I could, as much as I like star the email or put it in a folder like that, I'm trying to remember. Like time goes so fast, and
Yeah.
life be life, and sometimes and it's just. Man, it could be like the last day to submit. So I gotta do this right now.
I'm glad I'm
Or
not the only one then. Oh man.
yeah, so it'd be like that sometimes. So
Yeah.
how?
So I actually got a question for you, or maybe you can
Yes.
give me some advice, since we're kind of like, I'm just starting the game. You've been in the game for a minute, and then there may be some other social work entrepreneurs out here or future entrepreneurs that are wanting to do something like I'm doing or whatever, like Tiana. She's another certified financial social worker you had on. Like what advice would you give to aspiring entrepreneurial social workers?
Oh man, like I said, I'm like, it's funny because when after COVID happened, I just like I was obviously working, and then I was doing my gym job as a substitute, you know, Zumba instructor in case somebody called out, whatever, and they put me into to teach a class. So I was actually furloughed from that job, so because of COVID. So can literally whatever popped in my head, I started, you know, watching podcasts about financial literacy and started buying books and kind of like started my financial journey. And then like the podcast just kind of like came out the blue. Just I always had an idea of, because I do have a broadcasting background in undergrad. And then like a friend of mine had a podcast and did an episode on how to start a podcast. And then a podcast I was listening to talked about how to make money on a podcast. I'm like, you can make some money doing a podcast. I'm like, okay. So that's kind of how I even try to start it. And then I would just say, like, to start whatever idea you have, like we're just throwing things in the wall. Sometimes you just got to do that. And then, or something that you're really, really passionate about, like be, you know, people call it passion projects, and kind of start doing that as a side hustle. So, the main thing is just really like to start, because a lot of people don't even start. They might have all these ideas and might write it down in notebooks, and it just stays in the notebook. So literally 2020, I think I joke around. I said it's like the COVID antibodies that was in my system that gave me these ideas, and kind of like, I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do this, like then started learning about, you know, 2020 was like, use your stimulus check to get an LLC. I know that was like a big controversy, especially on Twitter, is like that people were complaining about the contractors talking about getting LLCs. That was a thing too. So it was like, I went to got an LLC, and then I learned like, hey, I'm moving to a state where it's traditionally beneficial for business owners in terms of business taxes, like, you know, Delaware. So like I'm moving into the state, like I open up an LLC, and you know, they went through who I went through. I won't mention the name because they could be a sponsor of the podcast. Got my LLC in place. So like literally just the ball started rolling, and then learning about, you know, business credit, and kind of like I try to put whatever I learn and just try to execute the best that I could at the time. And whether it be when I purchased my home, and just change, I try to initially get my car and my business name initially when I first got the car, and that took a process, and eventually got my car and my business name. That took forever, but I did it. And now learning about student loans, and then obviously with past episodes I've done on student loans, but what I've learned, and kind of like, this is what I've learned, this is what the government is trying to do for us in terms of student loans, and kind of put that into practice too. And I literally July 1st, I'm like checking my email, because like I will be done this summer, or I should be done,
Nice.
or with those darn loans. So
Oh man, that's gonna be a huge relief, man.
yes.
I can just feel the anticipation in
So
your voice.
July 1st cannot come soon enough,
Oh
and I
man.
hate the summer.
You got like a countdown clock in your on your phone or something like that now? Oh
Like,
man.
so just literally start and like talk to people, go like, no, DMs still work, or you know, just talk to people, go to conferences. Like I was, you know, NESW got a big conference, you know, coming up in DC. So, you know, if you're able to go in person, I know they got it online. If you can't make it in person, you know, do it online, and or any other conference in your state, go to your state. You know, whether you like NESW or don't, like, still go to the conference. Or I went to the Millennial Social Work Conference in March, so I went to that, and you know, presented and met people I never met before. So it was, or re meeting people, or I met people online, like I said, that I finally meet them and like in person. So it's like kind of do that. And LinkedIn is a great source, and kind of tapping with people. That's how we met, and here we are connecting and doing a podcast episode. So
Right, that's true.
literally, there's just different ways. Just obviously be respectful of people's times, and like, people don't owe you anything that with their time, so that people could be funny with that. So it's like, should I send an email or not, whatever. So like, the worst a person can say is no, and like, I'm gonna be 45, or no is not really going to bother me unless I was
Right.
unless I'm like looking for a job, and it's a job I really want, and they say no, then I'd be upset. Besides that, no is like doesn't bother me too much anymore. So yeah, just kind of you're on the right track. It doesn't matter. I know for myself, like I've as much as people tell me like you're doing amazing work, is like for me it's like not enough is not where I'm still trying to figure out where my ultimate lane is going to be, since I've like learned so much, especially these last, especially from the Millennial Social Work Conference, of like what I could do, like my transferable skills, and try to put it into practice to, like you said, to make more money for my family and pay these bills off, and would love to pay my house off and car off and all that stuff, and have all this, debt, especially on the business side that I created for myself, and kind of, really kind of get the ball rolling in terms of my business. So, yeah, just kind of start. Long-winded answers, just start
No, that's great.
whatever's in your head, just start.
So I was just curious if you could
And talk, get a business coach.
If you had to do it over again, how would you start your career off nowadays? Or what would you use different? Or what would you do differently if you
I
had all the
think
technology and stuff?
part of why I had to also pivot, because, and I no longer teach Zumba, is I actually have a nerve issue in my foot. So I got plantar fasciitis plus a nerve issue in my foot, and I waited a long time to see a foot doctor. And so once I started seeing a foot doctor, I was getting cortisone shots in my feet to even like teach classes or go to the gym, and then I'll get a cortisone shot, and then an hour later I'm like doing the Zumba class. Like
Wow,
I wouldn't
that's hardcore.
recommend to do that to anybody. So but it got me in shape, and especially after, talk about divorce and stuff, when my Stella got his groove back phase in 2015, 2016, like when I was single before I met my second wife, losing weight, feeling good, like, obviously the dating apps, and got a there was never like it was always pictures of me and my kids, never a solo picture, and I had to like, I gotta look good, take these selfies and post them. So it's like, kind of get back into some sort of shape, and Zumba helped. And so I was doing, self-care for us social workers. We out literally like saving clients' lives while risking our own lives, and like, and then poetry came out of that, like came out with my poetry book. And but I didn't do the market research whether people would be interested in that. So I think that would be the main thing first, is what are you passionate about, and see, reach out to see if there's any guards, any interest. If there is interest, then kind of like start the ball rolling. That number one, I think, would be do different. That probably would have saved me a whole lot of money. But you live and you learn. And that to a point was like last year, like, no, I gotta cut back on expenses I shouldn't be spending anyway, and let me go use that to hire a business coach. So like, this is what I want to do now. This is what I'm, like, I already have some of this knowledge, and how to do like set up the websites and like best email to marketing tools to use, and now with AI, try to figure that out and all those little things now that we learn as we go. So definitely like the gauge, like see those research people actually would be interested in buying that. That would be my first thing now would definitely change.
Well, I'm going to speak out of turn, but I think that maybe you should start a coaching business of your own because you got a lot of great knowledge up there, and I think there would be tons of people out there that would be willing to use your services, myself included.
I'm working on that now. I started to
Okay,
do
cool.
that on
I didn't mean
regarding
to.
the
That, no.
finances.
Okay. Well, I guess we gotta work together then,
Yeah, that
huh?
could be an option too.
Yeah. I'm just like I said, just to be in your orbit is awesome. So, if anything I could do to help, I'm down to help. But then,
Yeah,
yeah,
likewise.
I think that's awesome. I think you should definitely be a coach, man, for sure.
Yeah, it's just a matter of making the time for it is my biggest thing now. I got family. I'm a caregiver of a soon to be, I lost count how old my dad's gonna be this weekend. I think he's gonna be 78. So he got more lives than a cat. God bless him,
A
but
happy early birthday to you.
he's kicking. So like
Yeah.
just caring for him, and caregiving is not easy. So
Nah, it's a lot.
and then full-time job and plus side business and podcasting, so I keep myself busy. So
Yeah. I'll say, I don't know. You can teach me time management at the very least. Because I need some help with that.
now sure, I'm still trying to figure out the time
That's a moving target for sure.
management. Yeah, absolutely. Just kind of be like fluid with your time and just like, all right, do this, and I definitely rest, and my rest be in my car, like jamming on my way home, or I'm not doing anything with my business, even though I should. Like I'm playing my PS4 and it's soon to be PS5 soon. So like then I regret, like, damn, I shouldn't be playing. I should be like trying to work on these
It's a
email marketing.
well, it's tough to balance,
But
yeah, because you
yeah, the
got self-care,
balance.
but then you're
Exactly.
working, like, yeah, it's a lot to balance, but you do
Yeah.
got to do self-care, so
No, absolutely.
yeah.
No, then I'll lose the rest of this hair that I
Looking good, man. You're looking good.
got. Oh man. Where could people find you?
Well, I'm building my website. It's going to be the firesocialworker.com, but or not the, it's just going to be firesocialworker.com. So that's coming soon. But for now, I'm mo mostly on Facebook at the Fire Social Worker. You can find my link tree that has all my socials, but essentially I'm going to test out the StreamYard app here soon, and I'm going to try to do the broadcast to multiple platforms and see how that works. I might even try that for the financial makeover show. I don't even know yet at this point. I'm just it's Sunday and I still don't have all that. But for now it's going to be on Facebook Live.
Okay.
Yeah, just you can hit me up on Facebook. Joseph at the fire social worker .com is my email. Yeah, I mean just hit me up in any way that you can. But yeah, keep an eye out for me, I guess. Fire social worker.
Awesome. Man, it's great talking to you, great connecting
Yeah,
with you, and
for sure, man.
keep up the great work.
Thank you. Thank you. You too, man. We'll stay in touch.
Absolutely.